Well, thank you for joining us, everyone. My name is Paul Staples. I'm an Associate Director in Grant Thornton's Regulatory Practice. This is our latest event in our Financial Services Resilience Series. Please do sign up for our other events by emailing the link that will appear on the following slide. And you can access either COVID insights and content on our website. So this morning, we will be discussing an important area of regulation, the client assets or CASS regime, which I know will be central to the roles of many of you who have joined us this morning. We're actually pleased to be welcoming over 200 of you today, counting, into my spare room, which is quite a feat of modern technology. But we have a wide range of CASS firms joining us today, and such is the broad reach of CASS. You come from all manner of roles and specialisms. We have oversight roles represented, people from operational and second and third line functions. And we do our utmost with diversity in the conversation that follows this morning. So what's to follow over the next hour or so? We're going to be looking at how CASS compliance is being impacted in the current environment, what the challenges for firms and yourselves personally for effective CASS compliance. We'll be asking and thinking about what actions firms should be taking, and also thinking about some of the longer term implications to our current predicament, and perhaps also some of the opportunities that it might provide. Much of our conversation will no doubt centre on COVID, naturally, but we'll look beyond that too. So if I could just pause at this moment, please, just with some housekeeping matters. If I could ask everyone to keep their microphone on mute, to turn off videos, that will help us. I know that some of you will be dialing in directly as well, and we've sent the slides to you in advance. We will share slides after this event. And I should also let you know that this recording, this session is being recorded. And again, this will be shared with you after the event. I hope you've all got a good connection and you can hear me clearly. Clearly, we are working from home like everyone else, and we hope that this will provide for an uninterrupted transmission. But thank you for your understanding in advance. So at this point, I'd like to introduce two of my close colleagues that are joining me today. First of all, Shameen Kazmi. Shameen Kazmi is a director in our financial services audit practice. She has over 17 years of experience. She's currently our technical and quality assurance specialist, primarily for CASS audits. Shameen also represents Grant Thornton at the Institute's CASS Working Group, and she's regularly called upon to present at industry events. I'm also pleased to welcome Stephen Clues. Stephen will be known to a number of you. He's a director in our regulatory practice and he specialises in CASS. Stephen has over 20 years of experience in industry and practice, including heads of compliance roles. He's a chartered accountant and MBA, and he also brings operational experience through running reconciliations and cash management teams. So CASS remains a regulatory priority. In recent years, there's been significant effort and investment on the part of firms to enhance their CASS compliance. And so our expectation is that most CASS firms should be fairly well prepared to weather this particular storm. But clearly, COVID presents a very different and broader challenge. It extends through the real economy, and it's testing the resilience of every single firm. And first and foremost, I think you all agree that this is a people crisis, but that will inevitably be seen through CASS compliance or non-compliance. The regulatory framework is working hard to limit the impact of COVID on financial services firms, and effective CASS compliance and resilience is part of this response. So at this stage, I'd like to bring in Shameen to provide an audit perspective. Shameen, morning.
Morning, Paul. Morning, everybody. Hi, Paul.
Thanks for joining us, Shameen. Shameen, clearly there's been no relaxation of the CASS rules through this turbulent period, despite the regulator offering some relaxation or forbearance elsewhere. There's certainly been no relaxation of the audit reporting requirements or the timeframes for CMARs. So given the fact that we are just approaching 4 months from December year ends, could you perhaps give us an insight into how CASS firms have been coping with finalizing their audits, but more generally through this difficult period?
Yeah, okay. So a lot of you with the December year ends would either have been lucky enough to have signed those audit opinions or hopefully being close to signing them within the next couple of days. So as Paul mentioned, clearly there's been no extension granted for the December year ends by the FCA, more so in terms of the expectation that majority of the audit work would have been done on those audits. Where there has been slight delays, the FCA has been very open, has been forthcoming that firms and auditors should communicate where there are certain delays expected and communicate in the way they would have were we not faced with the current situation. So I say for the December year ends, we are in a much more comfortable position, I'd like to say. There are very few across our clients as well who have had certain delays in just completing the work, but predominantly there hasn't been an impact on the audit opinion as such. If you think about the CASS audit opinion, it's not forward-looking. And we've sought that clarification from the FCA as well, that in terms of the December year end, really, there shouldn't be an impact on the audit opinion in light of the current environment, unless clearly, there was some sort of limitation in terms of gaining the audit evidence. So that's really the December year ends and how they're looking.
And perhaps an important part of the audit reports is clearly the management comments or responses. If firms are undertaking some form of improvement or remediation that perhaps may have been impacted by the current situation, would you expect that to be reflected in the commentary?
So in terms of the December year ends, that's on breaches that occurred during the last period. So really post that, the firm comments would have reflected what remediation plans or things they've done since and presumably pre-lockdown. So I wouldn't expect to see a lot of that commentary coming in through the firm comments for the December year ends. That would be more prevalent in all the period ends post December, really.
Mm-hmm. And I guess as we move towards March year ends and really getting into some of your procedures now, are you anticipating some more practical challenges to delivering the audits, to accessing the necessary evidence from firms?
So that's where the challenge really lies at the moment from the audit point of view. So any periods ends post December, and we've got more so March year ends, and March year ends are more prevalent across the industry, I'd say, as opposed to January and February ones. That's where the real challenge is at the moment, because we, based on our conversations with clients and certain discussions, there has been certain challenges faced in terms of systems and controls. It's difficult for us as auditors to take that period post the lockdown to be very consistent with the period before that. So when we will do our testing and our audit approach, we pretty much have to have a different angle on it in terms of the stress testing during that period. What were the systems and controls during post the lockdown, and have to take that into consideration during our audit. Based on our discussions with the FCA as well, and with clients, what's coming to light is really that we would expect firms to be really looking at those systems and controls, how they've changed, be it additional controls, be it amended controls, be it controls that didn't work and they had to put in certain other mitigating factors in there. So we would expect firms, and we're having those conversations on our post December year ends, that how have the controls changed and how is that going to impact our testing and audit approach as well, really?
Yeah, sure. So you know, I think it's probably fair to say the firms would have had to modify or perhaps in certain areas even relax some of their controls, and presumably that would be an expectation of you to get your head around that and to understand how firms have managed that transition.
Yes, and that's right. And I think that's the one of the reasons as well, because for the March year ends and after that as well, during our interim work, in our experience, some of that has been pushed out. And the reasons are that firms are not ready yet to engage with us and give us that, you know, level of details around the, as you said, you know, the amended controls or the new controls that are in place, or they're dealing with how to put the best controls in place, really, to ensure CASS compliance. So they're still, in certain cases, have been fine-tuning them, amending them. So some of our work has been pushed back on the sort of post the lockdown or the March year ends and or the January year ends. And I can see that there might be a potential impact on the reporting deadlines as well. Mm-hmm. If we are unable to, you know, complete our work and get enough evidence, you know, to carry out a reasonable assurance opinion on them. The other thing I just, you know, say is that, so we have already preempted this conversation with the FCA, and it remains to be seen, and they're open to it, as to if there will be any potential impact on the opinion based on, you know, the way we carry out our work remotely, what limitations we come across, challenges. But that's a discussion to be had at the moment.
I suppose, as always, you know, you'd advise firms to keep that open dialogue and manage the regulators' expectations if they foresee challenges in meeting that reporting deadline.
Oh, yes. Yeah. So that reporting deadline, you know, whilst we communicate to the FCA in terms of not being able to submit that report, the FCA in this current environment very much expects not only us to report any reportable breaches under our statutory duty, that has been reminded to the audit firms, but also to remind the regulated firms of their duty under Principle 11, because there is an expectation that, you know, controls and systems won't work as smoothly as expected, really.
And Shamim, what about some of the more practical challenges of getting the necessary audit evidence? Because clearly, you know, the bar hasn't been lowered in terms of what you need to get sufficient reasonable assurance. I'm thinking about perhaps something like IT general controls, where the practical challenge of auditing that remotely could be quite difficult.
Yeah, and I guess that's where the conversations have to be held, and we do need regulated firms to do some work around that, because we need to almost take a step back and understand what exactly has happened in this period and what exactly has changed, even in terms of IT controls. Has there been a breakdown or change or relaxation on some of the IT controls? Can we actually, you know, do we have to amend our testing or amend our audit approach to pretty much have this period in isolation, look at the ITGC in this period as opposed to the remaining period? In terms of the access and clear, you know, remote walkthroughs as well, the challenges are heightened in terms of where their third parties or TPAs involved and functions are outsourced. So challenges remain there. And I guess, the absolute key thing here is communication with the clients, really. And that's what we're trying to do, really trying to get our head around and get a feel for what exactly has changed and how will it impact our audit approach and our testing and present challenges to us, because we will have to amend our audit approach, because what we don't want to do is be in a position towards the end of the audit where we can't justify to the FCA that actually the work we did and the way we did it, on the basis of that, we can actually give a reasonable assurance opinion.
Yes, I mean, clearly getting into the realms of limitations of scope is not really a desirable position for a firm to be in without very justifiable reason.
Yeah, true, agreed, yeah.
So I'd just like to move on, and I know that you meet with the FCA on a regular basis. Could you please give us a flavour of some of the matters that have been discussed more recently to give firms an impression of what's on the FCA's radar?
Yeah, so we do meet regularly with the FCA, and we actually had a meeting post-lockdown. So clearly, you know, the biggest concern or topic on the FCA's mind was the current situation and how the CASS compliance is fitting into it. So the raid focus very much remains on firms being able to demonstrate operational resilience, and with the key and primary focus of the firms being on segregation and protection of the client assets. And with that in mind, which is why, you know, they really sort of focused on and encouraged us to communicate with our clients as well, to put it on the forefront that the FCA really would like an open dialogue and communication. So any breakdown in rules where firms are having issues with practical challenges of complying with certain CAS rules, they would prefer an open communication with the regulator on that. Some of the other areas which remain on the FCA's radar are clearly with the SMCR coming in for the solo regulated firms in December. How is that fitting and how is that bedded in? Really, has there been a dilution in the role of the CF10A, and how is the CF10A, has it really mapped onto the PR role? But I'm sure Stephen, you know, and you will pick on that later.
The prescribed responsibility and how firms may have structured those responsibilities and the implications to good CASS governance.
Yes, so that's really still an area of concern or area of focus for the FCA, which they will pick up on. Some of the other areas has to do with automation. So the FCA has always been quite keen on automation and seeing how the IT changes or the level of automation plays out and sort of fits in with the CASS compliance. So they, it's a matter of seeing does and a degree of automation lead to reduced breaches? Does it? Is there a direct correlation? So there were discussions around that and getting a feel for that. Secondly, how are firms very receptive to automation? Do they really look at it in terms of that there's a degree, there has to be a cost-benefit analysis, right? The way I always see automation is, it's an enabler as well, but there's a risk as well, because if you go to great extents in automation and you come to, put really sophisticated and complex systems where you're relying on for your CASS compliance, we come across occasions where really very few people really know what's in the black box or the program, the coding, and it's automated to such a great degree of extent that it's difficult to demonstrate compliance. So that's quite important. So automation remains one of the focus areas as well, and its relation with the breaches. The three lines of defense, again, that remains an area of focus for the FCA. So they appreciate that not all firms might have an internal audit function. But for the small and medium-sized firms, they do expect some level of sort of demonstration by the firms.
Yes, I mean, we should say that there's been a huge range of firms that have joined us on this call this morning, from global organisations all the way to smaller firms, and clearly not all firms have the luxury of a fully fledged three lines of defence. So, what would your advice be to those smaller firms that perhaps don't have that luxury?
So it's not all about having the very formal internal audit function. It's about demonstrating that actually at different points in the year, you are carrying out some sort of compliance monitoring. It could be on internal compliance monitoring program. It doesn't have to be massively extensive and complicated, but it's really the demonstration that somebody is taking a step back and checking independently, from a high level that, the CASS compliance is working and there are areas which need improvement, and there's sort of an independent check. Now, that could be done through internal compliance monitoring reviews, or, you can do it on a regular basis through external compliance reviews as well.
Yeah, clearly CASS assurance can be gained through a number of different routes. And I think, certainly in terms of the interactions I've seen with the regulator, that there's an expectation that there is a coherent plan or program for CASS assurance and tailoring that to the size and complexity of your business. Is that fair?
Yes, that's right. So the FCA very much considered and appreciates the concept of proportionality. And I think as auditors, we look at that as well. It's all about demonstrating a good CASS culture and governance, really. And at the end of it, the whole three lines of defense and the monitoring, you know, the CASS committees or the oversight and the challenge. And it's really the challenge that we look for. And as long as firms can demonstrate that, then I think that's, you know, that's a good place to begin.
And if I could just go back to your comments around automation, we should add that the FCA has issued some COVID guidance, I think on the 6th of April, specifically on CASS, and it acknowledged that firms may well have had to defer certain CASS improvement or remediation plans during this period. How will you go about assessing firms' response to that as an auditor?
Yeah, so we are aware that, you know, as part of good CASS, you know, sort of compliance, firms do move towards automation and move away from manual controls where they can and where they can see benefits of it. So they have been, you know, firms do undertake automation programs, and there are certain programs in place. And where they have been put back as a result of the current situation, so the FCA's guidance is very much of communication again as well. So in the firm comments or as part of communication with the FCA, where firms have communicated that they are undertaking these programs and they have been put on hold, you know, I would just encourage open communication with the auditors and the regulators, really. So when we do the work as well, when we look at certain, for instance, there was maybe they put in place a program to deal with say reconciliation breaks, right? Really in a timely manner, picking them up more promptly. But that has been delayed and we still see a lot of breaches during our period of audit. At least we can evidence, as long as we can evidence communication that actually this program was put on hold or delayed because of the current situation, there's a valid reason. And the FCA would take that into account as well when they look at the reports. And if it's reflected in the firm's comments, I'm sure, you know, they'll be open to it and more understanding to it, really.
And briefly, just before we go on to your other slide, because inevitably there's so much to cover, but root cause analysis, you know, firms would have just gone through a very chaotic time, presumably, in terms of actually trying to stabilize the controls environment and perhaps now reach a more steady footing. You know, perhaps now is the time to pause and think about the operational transactional breaches that might have picked up through this time and perform some root cause analysis in on a deeper level. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's a fair comment. So root cause analysis has always been, you know, one of the top things for the FCA. When they follow up with us as audit firms as well on the audit reports, that is something they're really interested in. And they do pick it up with the firms as well. So I would say in this environment and current environment where they may have been, I mean, we have yet to see, but where there may have been increases in the level of breaches, and there is a challenge for, you know, how to carry out these root cause analysis to gain the, you know, get the relevant information, the relevant approvals. I would expect and, you know, encourage firms to still really keep that tight because that remains on the radar of the FCA. And I think in any of the breaches that come through this period, they would expect, you know, a good challenge and a good level of root cause analysis to have been done.
I guess the tendency or the inclination, it can often just be to put transactional breaches down to human error or manual failure, and perhaps actually there would be benefit in going somewhat deeper and actually understanding why that manual process requires so many physical handoffs, for example, rather than just a fairly superficial analysis of the breach.
Yeah, and that's right, and especially more so in this current environment where processes and controls may have been amended, and if the root cause analysis isn't done in a timely manner, firms may lose the opportunities to actually have a sense check of if something which has been changed is working or not.
Okay, yeah. Shemaine, could we also touch on what's come out of the FRC? There's been a new assurance standard that you know has probably impacted the audit community in terms of their audit approach more than firms directly, but it would be useful if you could just summarize for us some of the key implications that firms may see coming through from the new standard.
Yeah. So on the revised standard, as a result of the post-implementation review that happened last year, so the new standard came out end of last year, effective 1st of Jan 2020 for the period. I have to say there wasn't a massive fundamental change in the standard. However, a few things were clarified and emphasized. For instance, there was greater clarity and guidance on giving on using SOC reports for the audits. So historically, there's been a lot of debate on how useful they are or can an auditor really rely on them during an audit. The debate continues on that because we do have to see if those reports are fit for purpose. Mm-hmm. And they're not always catering to the relevant CASS systems and controls, and that may evolve over time. But as we stand, there is an ability to use those reports in the audit. But obviously, given the auditor gets comfortable with the independence, the competence, and the skill of the provider of that report. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the things. The other thing was a lot more focus on IT controls and IT testing, IT environment. That's always been there, but the revised standard made it much more explicit. Mm-hmm. For the auditors to consider that. And clearly with that in mind, we do require the firms to pay more attention and bring that into their risk assessment and demonstrate that they've actually also considered the whole IT environment as well as the IT controls. So that's another change. The only other thing is really on the priority reporting to those charged with governance. So yes. You must be aware, clearly, there is a reporting of deficiencies or control significant matters to those charged with governance as part of the CAS audit. But the FCA would really, through the FRC standard, they'd really like to see more priority reporting in that, such that the very important or key control issues and matters are highlighted upfront, really.
Yes, and those management letter points aren't necessarily shared out of course with the regulator, but clearly they're a useful means to demonstrate where wider recommendations or enhancements are taking place.
Yeah, and the regulator can ask for them, and they have in the past.
So just with the last minute or so that we've got left together, Shameen, you know, CASS is very detailed, onerous regime. Notwithstanding that, there's a fair degree of interpretation in certain areas, and I know that this is a bit of a bugbear for many firms in terms of the frustration that can come from that. You know, what steps is the audit community and the wider industry taking to perhaps help firms in that regard?
So you said it right. We often get challenged, and we have really colourful debates on the different levels of interpretations amongst audit firms. Unfortunately, that remains. But a welcome change was that as part of the CP that the FRC put out last year for the post-implementation review, they did welcome a CAS industry forum for the industry regulated firms, the auditors, and the regulators as well. There has been certain movement and mobilization on that, but that is yet to take shape, but the FRC is receptive to it. But the way we see it, the only way this forum would really be helpful and work would be if the regulators actually step in more than an observer capacity. Mm-hmm. And that's mm-hmm. when, you know, the forum will really be of use.
Okay, well, we look forward to hearing what comes from that. Thanks, Shameen. Yeah. I'd like at this stage to bring in Stephen Clues. Morning, Stephen.
Morning, Paul. Morning, Shameen. Morning, everyone.
Stephen, the recent FCA business plan is significantly shorter than what we've been accustomed to in recent years. Notwithstanding that, one of the key priorities alongside COVID is to protect consumers. You know, clearly this is central to CASS, and I would say that it's never been more important than ever in the current climate. We are seeing the regulator clearly stretch, reprioritizing its activities quite necessarily so. There's also been some guidance from the FCA that I referred to earlier, or that was sent out on the 6th of April. I think it'd be useful for us to refer to some of that, but perhaps firms will be able to digest that in their own time. From an advisory perspective, can you give us a sense of some of the risks that you see coming from this current situation?
Sure, thanks very much. Yes, I think it's fair to say that many firms will have adapted that guidance that came out now 3 weeks ago from FCA, and there've been a number of commentators who've spoken about it. I think at a more high level, firms need to now start thinking about the way forward. There can obviously be a look back, so there has already been massive change for firms, and there will be more to come. FCA in the very beginning designated those people working with client assets as key workers. Working from home has certainly been easier for some organisations than others. And it's probably fair to say that some firms struggled, certainly in the beginning, but are now adapting to the new normal. That's meant that firms have had to adapt their client money processes, whether that's reconciliations, system access, payments, operational controls and oversight. At the same time, the firms have had to cope with massive amounts of market volatility. Transaction volumes have varied. All of this happened around tax year end as well, affecting the investment community. So perhaps now firms need to not only reflect from a CASS perspective, but also say, well, what happens after lockdown? We know from the statement from the government yesterday that lockdown isn't ending immediately. But it's going to take a while before we're back to anything like normal business. And that isn't going to be the same as it was before. Home working may continue for many months yet. There's been discussions about shift working, for example, if firms do return to work and maintaining social distancing. So we may even get a second lockdown. And firms now certainly need to be thinking about that, and while there will certainly be more readiness next time, there will still be change to processes building on the learning from this experience.
I mean, hopefully firms by now have reached a position where they feel that they've got things under control and things have stabilized, but presumably now firms need to look towards a more sustainable footing. Would you agree?
Yes, and I think that's going to, certainly from a CASS perspective, those changes that firms have had in processes, in controls and oversight now need to be documented and reflected in all manner of things. They need to be approved by the various committees. Some firms may, for example, have made significant changes that need to be reflected in the CASS resolution pack, whether that's in terms of key individuals or processes or business activities even. And that should have been updated. That's perhaps even more important in the current uncertain situation, even though it may not have been a priority, as firms actually struggled with the core operational resilience of processes.
Sorry, Stephen, just to interject. The CASS resolution pack, clearly comes into the forefront of people's minds in these particular times. There is the 5-day rule to update changes to that. So presumably it would be good practice to lift the lid on those.
Yes, and certainly with home working, to even test it and see whether those links still work from a home environment.
Mm-hmm. Can we just move on to the CASS committee's role in all of this? Because most firms have a fairly established CASS committee that perhaps meets on a monthly basis, has a fairly standing agenda. What should CASS committees be thinking about, and what sort of questions should they be asking at this time?
Well, we might wonder whether CASS committees have actually been more active during this period. While communication may have been more difficult, hopefully the existence or the emergence of new technologies has facilitated online meetings, whether through Skype, Teams or even Zoom. But CASS committees will now have a lot to consider. There's the operational change I've mentioned. There may well have been more breaches. There are now amended controls, possibly firms having to adapt policies and get those approved. So I would expect that the CASS committee has probably been quite busy in the virtual world, maintaining scrutiny over operations. And hopefully they are looking to keep strong oversight. And I would probably suggest that at the moment, one meeting a month may not be sufficient. And it's not only CASS committees. The CASS committee will obviously have received certain MI in whatever form that is. But the boards also need to be involved. And we have to think now that, that SMCR has taken effect for most firms. And the senior manager who has that prescribed responsibility will need to have had appropriate information and probably some degree of active involvement in the process, whether that's sitting in alongside the CASS committee and certainly being made aware of decisions and key matters that have affected those the situation. CASS committees obviously need to make sure that there's a particularly robust process in place. The CASS committees and boards should be providing appropriate operational challenge in the circumstance, however difficult that may be, and making sure that issues are being properly investigated and that there are really as few control weaknesses as possible. And also from a governance perspective, we might find that audit and risk committees are probably also having to play their part. We'll probably discuss that in the context of second and third line shortly.
Yes, and certainly in my experience, sometimes there is a clear linkage between, for example, the CASS committee and other conversations that are being had at, say, a risk committee level.
Yes, and I think if we then move on to risk, I think it's probably fair to say that risk of a pandemic was probably not on risk registers of many firms. It's now important that the new risk is now looked at, that that's considered as part of the risk assessment process. And we may find now that risk committees or the CASS committees in smaller firms are now thinking of the implications of those changes and how that may affect the risk assessment, both at the firm level and the more detailed level when you think about the CASS risk assessment specifically, as well as moving through to the rules mappings that all firms are now expected to be maintaining. What has been the impact of that change on CASS processes and procedures? And even if it's not fully thought through yet, it's probably something that needs to be picked up pretty quickly. So I would expect that there are probably going to be firms now looking at their risk assessments based on the hindsight and perhaps the mitigating controls that firms have had to introduce and cope with during this pandemic, that those are reflected. Risk teams perhaps need to be consulted and about the implications on whether all the risks have been properly considered and reflected in the risk documentation, and whether indeed the mitigating controls need to be reassessed in the light of this new risk.
I mean, Stephen, is it fair to say that certain changes to the controls environment may have been very purposeful and may have been intended? Some, on the other hand, may have happened under the radar. So, you know, on the point of breach MI management information, clearly a CF10A can only will only be informed by the information that's been put in front of them, so they may need to look a little bit beneath the surface.
Yes, yeah, I think that's fair, Paul. I think you would hope that the CASS oversight manager is going to have been delving particularly carefully into issues that they have been dealing on a face-to-face level with their teams, making sure that they've got a full handle on the operational resilience and how the firm has actually dealt with that and any changes that have been necessary, and assessing whether those are adequate and do actually meet the risks going forward. It may well be that there have been temporary controls which are now in a position to be enhanced, certainly as more people return to frontline work, if people have been unfortunate enough to have had to self-isolate and been ill.
I mean, it seems as if there's all manner of risks that might have to the controls environment that might have come out of the current situation. I'm thinking about controls that might have been circumvented, whether intentionally or otherwise, diminished segregation of duties. What about, you know, we've also heard indications of control functions that have been backfilling first line teams. So how do you see the three lines of defence being impacted through this period?
Well, I think the certainly we know that a number of firms have struggled with staff absence, and I've had conversations with a number of people from internal audit who've been brought in to assist with first line support. Over time, the second and third line roles will probably need to move back to their original role. I think there's clearly going to be some gap, perhaps, in what second and third line activities have been. CASS was probably only one element of that, and clearly across a wider framework, firms are now going to have to look and see whether additional work is required. It may be specifically that any CASS reviews that either second or third line had planned were over a specific focus area, perhaps where there'd been breaches before. And maybe now the firms need to sort of step back and take a view as to whether they need to provide additional assurance, particularly during this period of disruption and where controls have been changed. There may well have been specific issues that have been identified. And it's clearly imperative that the firm needs to take its time to look at these, identify them, check whether they're appropriately rigorous, check that things have been documented properly, and make sure that if there are any issues that are identified during these reviews, that they are picked up before the next audit season kicks off. It's also fair to say that internal audit and compliance monitoring are also operating under a new normal. We saw before the lockdown that many more people from internal audit were having to do their work away from the office. Obviously, since lockdown, everyone's working from home. So to the extent that internal audit and compliance monitoring may actually be more difficult, you can go through, and this would be the same for auditors, you can go through a process of online, but can you really test how rigorous that process has been? So certainly those teams are now going to have to adapt to that new way of working and make sure that they can carry out sufficiently rigorous oversight. And just to make sure we've covered that point, temporary controls may need to be looked at. They may change again before the end of the year. And so it's important that second and third line are having those conversations now with first line to understand what is happening, when something can be tested, is it going to be changing again? Are there any specific issues that have arisen during this crisis that need particular review or that first line would like additional assurance or oversight on? And from a second line perspective, have all the risks been adequately addressed? And I think that's where it's important that the conversations happen between the three lines of defence.
So it sounds as if second and third line have certainly got a role to play here in terms of that CASS impact assessment, if we can kind of call it that, and that might take numerous strands in terms of the extent to which the control environment has had to be amended or
yes.
Not.
No, I think that's fair. And I think another challenge that first, second and third line have got to have in terms of oversight and challenge is what's happened with the outsourcing community. Outsourcers will similarly have been affected by the pandemic. Obviously, there have been different lockdowns in different parts of the world. Some firms will have insourced work because their outsourced arrangements couldn't necessarily carry on. And this doesn't just affect CASS. We know it's particularly affected those firms who've got outsourced call centres overseas. But it's important for the firm to understand from first, second and third line perspective how the controls were affected within the outsource provider. How does the new normal with home working affect their ability to conduct monitoring and oversight? And indeed, how have the outsourcer's own compliance monitoring and internal audit functions been affected? Because they will have the same operational challenges as the firm's own functions will have.
I mean, firms can sometimes struggle at the best of times in terms of getting sufficient management information and comfortable oversight of their TPA, Stephen. So perhaps the challenge becomes even greater through this period.
Yes, I think the firms now have to stand back and take a look at what they consider to be an adequate oversight model. Some firms will have had planned visits to their third-party administrators, for example, on the cards, or may have a regular program of visits, whether it be by first line, second line or third line, to that outsource provider. There's clearly been a hiatus, and there's probably not a great deal to see actually when you do a visit. So firms are now going to have to look at their oversight models and do perhaps a detailed assessment and see what additional risks there are by not being able to conduct that on-site activity. Clearly, even if we get back post-lockdown, there are going to be a lot of firms wanting to do the same kind of oversight, and that's going to provide an operational challenge for the outsource providers themselves. Accommodating visits when they've still got auditors and the BAU activity to go on.
Indeed, indeed. I'd just like to pause at this moment and just ask our audience that if they do have any questions they'd like to pose to us towards the end of this session, please do use the messaging function, and we'll look to answer as many of those as we can in the next few minutes. But Stephen, just to bring us towards perhaps some of your concluding points, could we think about FCA activity and perhaps what the future may hold? I know that before the lockdown, we were seeing a slight uptick in certain skilled person activity. What do you see happening over the coming months?
Well, I think it's fair that FCA has made clear by the relaxation of reporting deadlines that it's still looking to monitor its CMAR activity. It's now got much better automated systems for picking out problems. And you've already discussed with Shameen those focus areas that it's looking at, such as reconciliation breaks, number of breaches. So I expect that will continue. It is fair to say that there was an uptick at the end of last year and the beginning of this in terms of the number of skilled person reports on CASS that were kicked off. We saw a number of those. We've also seen evidence that certainly those that hadn't actually started by the time of the lockdown have now been deferred for, at the moment, an indefinite period, perhaps while FCA has had to reprioritise its activities. We don't know what prompted FCA to actually step up that 166 activity before lockdown, whether that was just particular sector focus or the luck of the draw, specific failings, or maybe better monitoring of the management information it was receiving. And at the moment, of course, we've got no idea when those deferred skilled person reports will pick up, or indeed how FCA will deal with specific failings arising from the situation. It may well be that firms have made notifications under Principle 11, for example, as you discussed earlier, about deferral of particular CASS improvement activity, or there may have been specific material breaches that firms have had to have disclosed. But CASS does remain a priority for FCA, and it's going to be interesting to see how those issues are actually reflected as we sort of perhaps get back to a bit more of a stable situation.
I mean, we obviously try to look to some of the silver linings from the current predicament, and perhaps there are some opportunities for firms to make certain control efficiencies through the current period. For example, if controls have been relaxed within risk appetite through this transition, maybe that's an opportunity to take a healthy look at the controls environment and whether things are as efficient as they could be.
Yes, I don't think firms are going to be able to use a period of stability to just sit down and to sit back and relax. There's still going to need to be an extensive focus on CASS, whether it's looking at risk assessments, the new procedures, making sure documentation is up to date. And there's only 6 months now, really, before the interim audit season for the next December year ends kicks off in earnest. And you can bet that auditors are going to be asking questions about how firms have dealt with the current situation. And perhaps that means that firms need to spend the time now, once they have a period of stability and they start to get to full workforce again, that they can take that action and have a good look at where they've been, what they've been through, and the way forward.
Okay, thanks, Stephen. I think I'd just like to move to some questions that have come in. I'm sure many of us would like to observe the 1 minute silence at 11 o'clock, so we do want to finish promptly. Thank you, Stephen. Shameen, we've had a question that's come in. Are we seeing an uptick in breaches across the industry? Have regulators' expectations changed at all as a result of COVID? Any thoughts on that one, Shameen?
So based on our current conversations with the clients and across some of the engagements as well, we haven't seen evidence yet, because as I said, you know, we're completing the December year ends. We have started some of the post-lockdown period CASS audits. There hasn't been a massive increase in breaches that we've seen, but the regulator's expectation is that as the controls would have been stressed during the post-lockdown period, there may well be some technical breaches, and that's our expectation as well. Based on some of the conversations with clients, with, you know, just dealing with some of the simple processes like banking of checks, you know, carrying out reconciliations of physical assets and all of that. So the expectation is, and based on our conversations, there might well be increase in breaches, but we haven't seen any firm evidence of it because we haven't really gone into the details of our work as yet.
I suppose it would be healthy, Shameen, if firms almost had an expectation of where they may expect to see an uptick in transactional breaches, or you know, you mentioned banking of checks, for example, that's highlighted on the FCA's guidance, and set those expectations for how breach volumes may have been changed through this period.
Yeah, and that's where it all comes down to when I mentioned earlier as to firm making an assessment in terms of the controls, how they've changed, how they've amended, how the risk profile has changed, really. How have they been stressed? So the risk may be well much higher for a process such as banking of checks or carrying out the physical reconciliation during this period, as opposed to in a very, you know, in a normal business as usual, really.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Shameen. Maybe one for you here, Stephen. So we've had a question. What do you expect firms to focus on when CASS activities are outsourced to third parties? Any specific areas of oversight that you'd expect to be prioritised or to form part of the course?
Well, I think one of the key areas is to understand exactly how those firms have, or how the outsourcers have actually managed to conduct business during this period. I know anecdotally from conversations with a few firms that there were some hiccups in the beginning, particularly around customer contacts, but that many outsourcers actually coped reasonably well, or at least seemed to. And I think this is where firms need to make sure that they've got a proper analysis of breaches. There was some perhaps concern that breaches may not be reported as quickly or thoroughly, and I think that's one area that the first line of firms can actually really focus on and make sure that they've done a thorough review. And this is also where the second and third lines need to have some input as well and make sure that they've given assurance certainly where there've been amended controls. And you can see situations, for example, where the outsource provider may well have had to adapt because, for example, they have a physical check that's, or some physical control that's now had to become a virtual control. And the firm will need to understand how those changes have been adapted, whether they've built in, whether they've been adequate and actually dealt with the risk that they're designed to mitigate, and whether those changes have then been documented. And we can see the complexity within some firms' rules mapping documents, for example, that they particularly where they're outsourced providers, the outsourcer has their own controls, and then the firm has their own mitigating controls. And I think it's going to be evident that firms are going to have to pick up and make sure that they've got all those changes documented. The auditors, when they come along, will want to check how the controls were operated both before and after the change. And that's something that will need to be continue to be monitored going forwards, as there may well be additional changes in controls that are required as we change to a new normal, or perhaps reflect an additional outbreak or pandemic.
And I think just in terms of the availability of management information, Stephen, clearly firms often can only rely on the information that's put in front of them, but that shows the emphasizes the importance of asking questions and deeper questions to get the assurance that they need.
Yes, and I think firms now will have, if they haven't already, they'll need to step up their contact with the outsource provider and make sure that they're fully aware of issues, that the MI has been particularly robust. And I think there have been areas of challenge before where MI is simply presented by the outsourcer and not subject to appropriate scrutiny to see how accurate it is. And I think this is firms' opportunity to step up and actually make sure that that's taken place.
Thank you, Stephen. So reluctantly, I'd have to bring things to a close there in terms of questions, but we will seek to come back to everyone individually on the further questions that have been put to us this morning. Thank you very much for that. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Shemaine, for your input and your insights this morning. That's been really interesting. So just to wrap up this morning then, CASS is clearly a highly prescriptive regime, but a number of aspects are open to interpretation, as we've heard. In the current climate, we would say that following the spirit and not just the letter of the CASS regulations has never been more important. There's been mention of Principle 10 and Principle 11 today in terms of a good dialogue with your auditors, with the regulator, and keeping those key principles of segregation, record keeping, reconciliation at the front of your mind through this difficult period. In conclusion, this has been and continues to be a test of firms' resilience. It's a heavy stress test on risk management, and it may well prompt opportunities for further enhancements to your CASS environment. Thank you for joining us this morning. Please do join us if you can, and if it's of interest, we have a series of COVID events on resilience that are running at the moment. On Thursday this week, my colleagues Tom Townsend and Vijay Rathore will be auditors are using COVID to evolve their strategies and unfortunately target clients and their infrastructure during this period. So I'm sure that will be an interesting session. Please do sign up to other sessions using that address there as you wish. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Enjoy the rest of your day. And I think we've just brought it to a close just before 11. Thank you for joining us and speak soon. Bye-bye.